very good morning to all of you. So myself, Dr. Suraj Soman. So I work as a scientist at CSIR NIIST, which is just like 1 kilometer from here. But it's the first time that I am coming to this college. And I thank Dr. Bobby for this invitation. And I am actually from a different sector, since all of you are engineers. So we can say like we are pseudo engineers to a greater extent, since my background is from science. But we do at the interface research involving various scientific aspects in physics, chemistry, material science, nanotechnology, and engineering to find out some realistic applications. So I designed my talk today as self-powered smart cities. So like we had a very wonderful discussion in the morning by Elangovan sir, where he had mentioned like the need for the smart cities. So today I'm going to talk to you on a totally different topic. Means once you are having the thing smart, how you are going to get it sustained? Because you also mentioned like we need not like have the things which are smart, we need to have the things which are actually sustainable. So that is where actually my talk will be focused on. And some activities right now we are being taken up at our institute in a way leading to the technologies. So we are a CSIR system. So CSIR is Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. So that is the national lab system in our country. We are having 37 national labs working in various sectors. And we have in our state National Institute for Interdisciplinary Science and Technology, NIIST, which is located quite nearby here. So we do have an interface between the chemical science, biological science, material science, leading to technologies. And the motto is, we say as we need to develop technologies which can support the life of 800 million people who are below the poverty line in a way to improve the quality of their life standard. That is our motto. So this is our institute, like you are always welcome to visit, it's very nearby. Now coming on to some of the activities that we do in our lab, like we do work a lot on the latest energy technologies like photovoltaics, electrochromic devices, thermoelectrics, OLEDs, like these days you are all seeing like the OLED televisions and all. So I do work at a area which is called upcoming photovoltaic technologies, and I am leading the group with solar photovoltaic technologies. So we all know like in the last few decades, we had seen like various industrial revolutions, starting from the industrial revolution one, like few decades back, where we went into the mechanization, then coming on to the introduction of electricity, and in the last decade we had seen the computer. And right now we stand at what we call as the fourth industrial revolution, which we coin as industry 4.0. And what is there in this industry 4.0? Like since we are in today's discussions, like we are going to speak about the smart cities. So what makes the city smart? How you can make the city smart? Means as human beings, like we are having the sense organs where we touch, feel and we see and we identify and we manipulate the things. But for the material world, how we can do that? How that becomes possible? That is done something by what we call as IoTs, that is coined and that we see around quite a lot like these days. So what is Internet of Things? So Internet of Things gives a physical life into the world of the machines and all. And that is a requirement when it comes to smart cities, whether it's a smart home, smart office, smart kind of transportation, all these things requires the IoT. And what is the predictions there? Currently, like there are around like 10 billion devices that is there in the IoT regime. And it is predicted that by 2020, there are going to be around like 50 billion devices in different sectors like automotive, healthcare, consumer electronics, utilities and all. Now, what is the issue regarding this? Like how these IoTs are powered? Like the IoTs involves lot of sensors, actuators and those kind of devices, and these are powered with batteries. And what is the issue there? The issue is that the battery will get drained at some point of time and you need to replace the batteries. Another major issue, the carbon footprint that you are going to create by dumping the batteries is too huge. And there is a recent report where the people went looking into the real predictions. Like back in 2015, it was predicted that there will be around like 1 trillion IoT devices that will be coming up. But later in by around like 2020, from 1 trillion, the prediction went down to 50 billion. And now like even IBM is coming down the prediction with around like 25 billion. So what is the reality? You need to have the industry, the fourth industrial revolution, the industry 4.0, which is supported by a lot of IoT devices. And the number of IoT devices is coming down. Then how you will realize the real potential of the smart cities or the fourth industrial revolution? And what are the problems into it? Like as I mentioned, the batteries is one of the major issues. Because instead of enjoying the benefits of your new data streams that you are generating in your big data environment, you are actually going to spend your precious time replacing the battery. So that is a trillion million problem. Like that means, like even if the 50 million devices that is coming into the IoT regime, if you are going to replace the battery, there will be enough number of batteries there circling the earth almost 4 times. So that is going to create a big environmental problem. So as sir mentioned like before, we need smart cities, we need smart transportation, we need everything to be smart. But it doesn't need to cause that these smart things will ultimately end to the damage of our environment. So these smart things need to be sustainable. So what is the solution for that? We need to develop self-powered systems. That means it will get its energy by itself. It is not depending upon any external power. It is not depending upon any battery. Like it will become a self-sustained system. And how it can be achieved? It can be achieved by different potentials. Like one thing is that you can actually get the energy from the light. You can get the energy from the heat, which are like the thermoelectric generators. You can get energy from the vibrations, which are the piezoelectric generators. So where is this IoTs or smart system mostly coming up? So these are coming up in closed atmospheres, like where there you won't be able to find the direct sunlight. So you, if you are looking into the light, like the conventional solar cells that you see around, like the silicon or the second generation thin films, this is capable of taking the direct sunlight. You need the direct sunlight in a way to generate the power from it. So in a way to support the IoT regime with self-powered system, you need to develop solar technology or the light harvesting technology which is capable of taking the indoor light. That means the light from the CFL or the LED or any indoor sources and convert that into the useful power to drive your electronics. So this is actually the area in which we are working. So we are actually the energy people who are trying to develop a new innovative technology that can support your IoT to get it completely self-powered. So this is a third generation photovoltaic technology, the first generation being silicon, second generation being thin films, and this is called DSEs, or generally we call it as dye-sensitized solar cells. So this is a translational technology that has the capability to harness all kinds of the light. It can be indoor light, it can be diffuse light, and convert that into the useful power by which you can actually support your electronics. And what it comes up, like you can see, like one advantage is that these kind of solar panels, you can make it transparent and you can have it in different colors. So where the application comes, like this is actually a real picture of a building facade where instead of your normal windows, you can't put a silicon solar panel there. Why? Because it is not transparent, your light will not come in. Second thing is that it is angle dependent. The moment you actually change the angle of incidence, and if your panel is not getting direct sunlight, you are not able to actually generate the exciton splitting and you won't get any power there. So this is actually a technology where you can make colorful solar panels with the transparency, which you can integrate into your buildings. Thereby you can have building integrated photovoltaic with the facade applications over there. So basically the structure of this solar panel consists of two conductive electrodes. In between that, like, there are three components, and the advantage here is that whatever be the components that we are using here are cheap and are locally available. So that means, like, the problem that we had with the first and second generation silicon, like we all say, make in India. Are we making silicon solar cells in India? You are all engineers. No, we are not having even a single solar panel that is manufactured in India. We are buying all the shingles and we are doing the job of a normal electrician by serially and parallelly interconnecting it. Is that what we want for our country? That is actually the issue. We already missed the bus. We can't get the panel done in a very cheaper rate. That's why the subsidies are coming up. So we need to develop the technologies which are indigenous and which can be locally manufactured using the locally available materials. Thereby we can reduce the cost out of it. So in this regard, what we are doing is we are working at the interface between the chemistry, material science, device physics and engineering in a way leading to improved performance and stability of the materials to product integration and the process portfolios. So when we go from lab level small area devices into a bigger panel, it goes through different stages. First thing is that you can't make a solar panel with your hand. You need to have the right equipments over there. So developing the equipments is the first stage. Second stage is the fabrication of your panels or the modules, and third stage is actually integrating it into some real application and exploring the potential of it. In this regard, last year in 2017, we were able to succeed in getting a project from the Department of Science and Technology where for the first time in our country, we developed a totally indigenous dye solar cell module fabrication facility here just 1 kilometer away from your institute. So this is actually a very new initiative that was done partnering with a industry which was located in Bangalore, and we were able to achieve close to around 60-70% cost reduction. That means whatever be the equipment, normally it is robotics and all. So these equipments are available in the international market. If you are buying from the international market, you have to pay somewhere between like 12-15 crore rupees. Instead of that, we are able to manufacture the entire robotic system for less than a crore. So that is actually a very big initiative, and this was actually selected by the Prime Minister on a special implementation and high priority category. And the current system, like the current setup that we have in our institute, it is capable of manufacturing panels from 5 cm by 5 cm size up to 30 cm by 30 cm of the panels. So the entire system was commissioned only a few months back. Right now we are optimizing the process. Here actually, this is a solar panel, a 5 cm by 5 cm solar panel that is made in our lab. And you can see, like, this is entirely, truly indigenous. Every material, every process, every equipment used are made in India. And you can see, like, with this panel, our own panel, like, in the outside atmosphere, we are getting close to around, like, 20 milliamps and, like, around 0.72 volts. So, like, we are still, like, in a way, tuning the process and the optimization thing. So, I will just quickly show you a video of our facility and what we have there in our lab. Process starts from here, where you get the conductive glasses cut into up, like sizes like 5 cm or like 10 cm. Then there is a screen printer by which you are actually depositing your semiconductor material. So it can be either platinum or like titanium dioxide kind of material. This is a unique system which is a 5-headed robot which was made for the first time globally, where we integrated 5 functionalities into a single unit. So what you are seeing here is that it is depositing silver grid lines which act as current collectors in your active material, like in your photo anode. So once your silver lines are deposited, then like you need to anneal it up. So the furnaces are custom designed in a way like it can be accessed from like all different regions, like from the four sides. And once you anneal it, some of the binders and the additives that are used in this material are getting completely like removed. And then you need to like actually put your active material which actually takes the light. So that is the dye. And then there is a counter electrode where you need to drill the holes on the substrate through which you at a later stage you fill a liquid electrolyte into the system. So once you are having your anode on the top of your conductive lines, you need to put the epoxy. So this epoxy will protect your grid line. Additionally, this is a sealant material which connects your anode and cathode together. So once you have your anode, your cathode ready, the pick and place system will take it up. It will align the anode and the cathode together, and it will place it in a perfect way. So in all these processes, it can be completely automized, and there will be some manual intervention also. But like invisibly, like if you are seeing some offset, like you have the flexibility in a way to change the parameters over there. So once that is done, the system will move into your chamber where you are shining the UV light, and you get the sealing of the module. And finally, like you fill the electrolyte, which is actually a system that comes in between both the electrodes, and you are having your final module out there. So this is actually in general like the process in which like we make the module, like the truly indigenous process. And now coming to the application, where you are going to use it. I mentioned like we are going to support the smart cities or the smart systems that are there in a way to create the smart cities. So one of the applications is like IoT based energy independent self-powered environmental sensor. As we all know, like in India, like it is not that like that common, but in European countries and all, if you are building up a building in a smart environment, you need to have a lot of sensors there. It could be CO sensor, it could be CO2 sensor, it could be a lot of sensors which are right now supported by the batteries. So we are partnering with this company Unison Technologies in Bangalore, where we are going to make a completely self-powered sensor system, and you will be getting an app like where you can actually see like what is the temperature, what is the humidity and those kind of parameters. Another very interesting development that we are right now doing is on making smart labels. You all know like the retail market, like for example you take potis. In potis, how many commodities are there? There may be like 10,000 or like there may be 50,000 commodities there. And what they are doing? They are putting the price tags or the labels which are in the paper. So what can be done like in a way to make it smart? Like you can have like smart labels like this. So this is actually a real picture that was taken from a shopping mall in Stockholm in Sweden. So they are having these smart labels like with n number of like this price tags, with just one computer and with one manpower, you can change or like you can put like, okay, 50% of 1000 rupees. In another 1 hour, like you can actually, based on what is there in the internet, that like the most available market price, you can change it. So these are smart label systems. So what we are trying to develop is right now is a totally energy independent smart label. So you just think like 50,000 commodities or 10,000 commodities, and you are going to change the batteries like every 6 months for this 10,000 batteries. It's a huge laborious process. So we want to get it completely self-powered. So this is actually one very recent innovation that is being taken up. And another part is like partnering with this Cochin Metro Rail Limited, where we are trying to put these kind of like indoor light harvesting panels with the metro cabins and also with the metro station. So this is also something that is right now taking up. And these are some real applications. So IoT is like something that comes in the indoor. So this particular technology can harness or capable of harnessing the indoor light that can be used for IoT. The second side of the application is the building integrated, the facade application. So these are some real installations. So this is a 50 kilowatt installation in Stockholm in a shopping mall. This is in China where they are having this 100 kilowatt, this dry solar installation. And this is what I mentioned. This is in Switzerland in EPFL, where one conference hall, actually the facade, the glass, the normally where we put the glasses, we are having this colored energy producing glasses. So what you are getting, like you are not losing any of your aesthetics. You are not losing your space. So what is the biggest issue for a state like Kerala when we speak about like smart or when we speak about solar? You know, like out of the total land area we are having in our state, only 1% is barren land. And if this 1% of the barren land itself, if we cover with the world's best efficient solar panel, the amount of energy generated will not be suitable for even a day's energy need for our state in the whole year. So what is required? We need to have integrated technologies where like the building integrated photovoltaic kind of technologies, which can be a very good supporting system. So this is where we stand, like where we make this kind of panels for one application is the self-powered wireless IoT devices, mobile energy and smart textiles is another application. Like we can get it into the flexible substrate like plastic, metals and all, where your mobile phone cover can be a solar panel. Your laptop's cover can be a solar panel, your iPad cover can be a solar panel. So this will become supporting system. Then the third one is the building integrated and the transportation integrated photovoltaics. And finally, like the remote area installations. So we are in tune with the government's requirement, like being a government institution, like the Make in India and those kind of things. And our motto is to convert everyday objects to independent power resources or the sources. So that is where we stand out. And this is actually a small video that we had made where one of the panel here that, yeah, so that is just powering a fan with the light. So whatever like I had shown here, this is actually a part of the team, like my students and the postdoctoral researchers that is working in our group who contributed into it. And thank you all, and you people can do a lot of things in it because we are scientists. We are developing this technology and the application comes from your side. You are people with electrical background, electronics background. Like you are always open to come to our lab to visit the facilities and like the electronic, the e-shelf label that I had told you. So I had a student who came from Pappanancode last year and he actually got this particular e-paper display. In Indian retail market, there is no e-paper display, so none of these are there. So there is a huge market potential there, and the conventional things that are used in the American market and European market are using either TFT or LCD, which takes a lot of time. So what this kid has done is that from China, he purchased the e-paper display. So e-paper displays are like what you see in your Amazon pads and all. So there, your power is, you need very low power. Once you actually put a message there, for sustaining the message, you don't need any power. Like you it will be in a sleep mode. And only it needs power in a way to change the message. So then he is actually right now programming it. And our part is like we will supply the energy thing, and then like we are trying to co-develop this particular system. So there is huge opportunities in this area. And I request all of you, like if some of you are interested, always you are welcome to contact me. Thank you. Thanks a lot.